Καλησπέρα σε όλους. Θα πω κάτι λίγο πρώτα στα ελληνικά και μετά στα γαλλικά ή στα αγγλικά. Εντάξει, πώς θέλουμε. Έχουμε σήμερα τη τιμή να έχουμε καλεσμένο το γιο του Άδωνη Κύρου, του οποίου είδατε χτες το πρώτο επεισόδιο της σειράς επιστημονικής φαντασίας Sial 4. Σε μετάφραση σε αγγλικούς υπότιτλους. Λέγεται Αριέλ Αχιλλεύς Κύρου, γιος του Άδωνη Άντο Κύρου, του σκηνοθέτη. Δεν ήρθε να μας μιλήσει μόνο για τον πατέρα του και για το πώς έζησε το σουρεαλιστικό κίνημα, αλλά ήρθε και να μας μιλήσει και για τη δουλειά τη δικιά του, που είναι πάρα πολύ ενδιαφέρουσα. Θα μιλάει στα γαλλικά, θα έχουμε μετάφραση στα αγγλικά, ώστε όλοι, γαλλόφωνοι ή μη, να καταλαβαίνετε.
Να πω πρώτα αυτά στα αγγλικά που είπατε.
Ευχαριστώ πολύ.
Un moment que je traduis oui. ce qu'il a juste dit. Good evening, everybody. Tonight, we have the honor to have as a guest Mr. Adonis Achilleas Ariel Kirou, who is Adonis Kirou's son. He is here not to speak only about his father's great work, but he's going to tell us other interesting things. Okay. Vous pouvez
Thanks.
Commencer.
Thanks. So, donc, oui. Kalispera sas. Catalano liro liro alenico. Elinica. Liro liro alenica. Catastrophas. Donc, voilà. I can speak English, but I will let Amalia speak in English because it will be easier like that. And I will speak in French. So I'm going to try to do it slowly. Non, c'est pas la peine de traduire ça. C'était dit en anglais en plus. Peut-être commencer peut-être en deux mots par me présenter, peut-être, avant de parler de mon père. Moi, j'ai toujours eu plusieurs activités. Celle qui nous concerne le plus directement ici, c'est ces deux livres dont je reparlerai tout à l'heure. Donc, un qui est sorti il y a un an, pour lequel j'ai eu pas mal de succès, vu ce type de livre, parce qu'il est tout petit. Voilà. C'est « Dans les imaginaires du futur ». J'en parlerai tout à l'heure, peut-être, en fait. Hein. Voilà, c'est réellement un travail qui prend la fiction, justement, comme une matière à penser et à réfléchir. C'est le principe même du livre. Voilà. Et donc, ça veut dire que les romans, les films, les séries dont je parle, je m'en sers au même titre que je me sers de philosophes comme Bernard Stiegler ou Bruno Latour pour penser le monde et pour essayer de le transformer.
Before starting talking about my father, I would like to tell you that I'm involved in quite a few things. The first one I'm going to talk to you about is a book called Dans les imaginaires du futur.
How could you translate that?
How could we? Inside the imaginary parts of the future, which is what we say in English, food for thought. That's what we call it. It has to do with thinking and. Vous avez dit quelque chose d'autre que
je me rappelle. Oui, c'est utiliser la fiction comme matière à penser.
Yes, sorry. When we use fiction, science fiction too, as a way of thinking.
Thanks. So, voilà, this book.
Donc, voilà. And this one, which is going to be out in France
Vous
in...
Vous pouvez parler en français.
Non, pardon. Et l'abécédique, voilà, l'abécédique, c'est un abécédaire du monde d'aujourd'hui vu au travers de Philippe K. Dick, l'écrivain de science-fiction. Voilà, ouais. Voilà donc, qui sort qui est une nouvelle édition augmentée d'un livre qui était sorti en 2009 et qui sort dans une semaine.
A new edition of a book of Back from the 90s, which will be issued in a week.
In a week. Ouais,
in a week. In a week.
Voilà. About Philip K. Dick.
About Philip K. Dick, le livre indispensable. Oui. Le
voilà,
livre,
c'est un.
A book about Philip K. Dick.
To say it quickly, it's a. It's exactly a sort of a style exercise.
Of this one,
is to say comment
utiliser un auteur comme Philip K. Dick pour penser le monde.
How voilà. We can use voilà. A work by Philip K. Dick to think about the world
and to change it,
and
if it
of
is possible.
Course, oui.
But there, it's we have quite a lot of work to change it. ouais, voilà. Donc, je vais commencer donc par parler dans un premier temps de Ado, puisque vous avez vu Ciel 4. Voilà. Donc.
I'm going to speak
about Ado Kirou, my father.
Oui, I'm going to speak about my father first.
Voilà. And after I will make je ferai une analyse de Ciel 4 au travers. De
and
idées.
Then I will analyze what you watched yesterday, if I'm not mistaken, via
my work. Voilà.
Via my way of thinking, my work.
Voilà. I thought about that in the car. So first about my father. Donc, I don't know if je ne sais pas si vous connaissez.
Oui.
Je ne sais pas si vous connaissez Adonis Kirou. Donc il est.
I don't know if you know who
voilà.
My father was.
Alors il est né en octobre 1923.
He was born in October
1923. Et il est mort en octobre 1985.
He died in October
85. Voilà. Donc à 62 ans.
At the age of 62.
Donc, ce qu'il faut savoir, c'est qu'il est issu, on va dire, plutôt de la haute bourgeoisie grecque, hein, d'une famille en fait qui est à l'origine d'un quotidien athénien qui s'appelle Hestia.
He's of Greek origin, and his families were responsible for. Newspaper in Athens called Hestia. Hestia was a Greek goddess.
Voilà, which qui existe encore et qui est toujours aussi mauvais.
And this newspaper still exists.
Oui, il existe encore. Ouais. Il est pire que jamais.
Il est toujours aussi mauvais.
Oui. And it's still that bad.
je me souviens.
You all know.
Voilà. Je me souviens. Je vais donner une anecdote parce que c'est toujours un peu drôle d'une discussion.
It's
voilà.
It's always ouais, ouais. A little funny.
C'était, je crois, c'était avant que le journal devienne vraiment ultra-libéral. C'était la vieille tradition royaliste à l'époque. Et j'étais avec mon parrain. Adonis Kirou.
My father Adonis.
Une sorte de vieux royaliste, plutôt sympathique.
Very likable and realist.
Royaliste.
Royaliste. He was for the king. I didn't get
it. Il était en train de se fâcher avec mes deux cousins, en fait, grecs.
He was very angry with his two Greek cousins, yes.
Notamment mon cousin direct qui s'appelle Nikos Kirou, donc le fils de la sœur de mon père.
Nikos Kirou was one of these cousins.
Banquier à Londres.
A banker, he was a banker.
And I heard him say in Greek and in French for me to listen. Okay. Vous êtes vraiment des bande de libéraux sans principe, sans valeur. Je préfère encore votre cousin qui est un anarchiste. Lui au moins, il a des idées. Voilà.
You lack principles, you lack values. You are even worse than your cousin who is a liberalist.
An anarchist.
Voilà. I heard an anarchist, yes. Voilà. You're even worse than him.
Donc c'est une manière de montrer la famille d'où venait mon père, avec laquelle il a, en fait, il a totalement coupé.
And he had no relations with this part of
just a little.
His family,
voilà.
Only a little.
Voilà, just a little. Why? Because he was a resistant against Nazis, and in the beginning of a civil war, he was of course on the left side and not on the right side. Oui, il était donc résistant. Il était résistant en fait. Hein, donc.
He already said it in English. He voilà. was in the Greek resistance on the left side or leftish side.
C'est ce qu'on appelait les communistes de l'intérieur. Hein, les communistes de l'intérieur.
Yes.
Voilà, oui, yeah. Comme avec Kostas Axelos,
yes.
Nikos Poulantzas et tous ces gens-là. Mm-hmm. Voilà.
Mm.
Voilà, et donc je le dis parce que ça a du sens par rapport au film que vous avez vu, par rapport à Ciel 4 en fait, et ça, on a beaucoup par rapport à la suite.
This is at a great extent related to the film. This is why he mentioned all that. I mentioned all that. So voilà.
Alors pour vous, donc il a eu une première rupture qui est, on va dire, presque une rupture révolutionnaire par rapport à sa famille. Donc étant plutôt d'extrême gauche.
Related to his family, we can say that he had this revolutionary side, communist side.
Voilà, anarchist, communist, between the two.
Yes.
It was difficult to understand sometimes. Et quand il est arrivé en France, il est tombé amoureux du surréalisme.
How he arrived in France, he was in love with the surrealism.
Et il a notamment écrit un livre majeur en France sur le cinéma qui s'appelle Le surréalisme au cinéma.
He wrote a book called The Surrealism in Cinema.
En 1953, hein, il est paru.
53.
Voilà, 53. C'est-à-dire 9 ans avant que je naisse. Voilà.
9 years before I was born.
Donc il a aussi écrit donc quelques années plus tard, à la fin des années 50, donc Amour, érotisme au cinéma.
9 years later, you said?
Well, no, by the end of the 50s.
At the end of the 50s, he also write
Amour et érotisme au cinéma.
Love and erotism in cinema.
Donc ces trois points sont importants parce que la révolution, le surréalisme, l'amour.
These three points are very important because the revolution, the surrealism and love.
Voilà. Avec une vision plutôt surréaliste de l'amour, l'amour total.
With a vision more surrealist.
Voilà. C'est quelque chose qu'on retrouve dans Ciel 4.
It's something that we refined. I didn't hear.
In Ciel 4. In Ciel 4.
In Ciel. Ciel 4, what you saw yesterday.
Voilà. Il est retourné en Grèce dans le court moment où les colonels se sont effacés, ont disparu, ont été virés avant qu'ils reviennent.
He came back to Greece at the moment the dictatorship of the generals broke out.
Et c'est de là qu'est né son premier film, Bloco, sur la résistance grecque dans un quartier d'Athènes.
Aristopoli. And his first film, au quartier latin.
Donc en 1965, c'est Bloco.
Ah, Bloco. It was voilà. Blocked because of that.
Voilà.
No.
Bloco.
Ah, Bloco. Ah, he shot the film, yeah. Yes.
Voilà, Bloco. Voilà. And so at that time, moi j'avais 2 ans et donc j'étais à 2 ans je parlais grec. Voilà.
Donc, I was 12 years old.
Non, I speak, 2 years old.
2 years old. I ouais, used to speak Greek at that time.
Voilà. Donc, Sial 4, c'est la série. Donc, elle est sortie en 1969, juste en Suisse.
The series called Sial 4 was short came out, sorry, in 1969.
Donc tout ça pour vous donner un peu un panorama. Ce qu'il faut que vous sachiez, c'est que mon père ne voulait jamais parler de la Grèce.
This just to give you a panorama of what was going on. His father didn't want to speak about Greece. He never spoke about Greece.
Parce qu'il a failli mourir, tout simplement. Et il a dû sa survie à une série de circonstances incroyables.
Donc il a failli mourir, en fait. Il a eu une balle dans le dos d'un
une balle dans le dos. Voilà.
It was unbelievable situation. That's why he didn't want to speak, but I didn't get what happened.
Il a failli mourir, tout simplement. Voilà. Il a failli mourir en 1945.
Il a reçu une balle
dans le dos. Voilà.
He had a stroke.
Someone
shot him.
He was shot.
Et c'était une balle tirée, une balle tirée, donc de. Il y avait encore les Allemands, c'était un temps soit peu le début de la guerre civile.
Nazis were still here, so I think we're talking about 1943, it was the first period 44, of the
1944.
Civil.
The first period, exactly.
Civil War,
exactly.
It officially started in 1946, but 1943, 1944, exactly. There was the Civil War in Greece.
Voilà. Yeah. Et donc voilà. Donc ça faisait partie en fait de mon environnement sans que ce soit forcément affirmé et dit, which is, voilà. It was a part of my environment, without saying it, in fact. Après, ce qui est important, c'est que mon univers, le premier livre que j'ai lu, par exemple.
What happened later, and this is what is important, is that the first book that I read.
C'était un livre, j'avais 10 ans, 10, 11 ans, j'avais. C'était un livre de Frederick Brown.
Was a book by Frederick Brown.
Martien Gaume. Martien Gaume. Martien
Martien. Habitants go home.
Voilà.
Habitants go home.
Yes. Voilà. So, je baignais dans un univers qui était un univers surréaliste. C'est en gros l'univers de Max Ernst, l'univers de Breton, l'univers. Voilà, un univers
surréaliste. So I was in an environment which was a surrealist. Mm-hmm. You mentioned two names. I didn't
Max Ernst.
Max Ernst.
Max Ernst. Voilà,
okay,
I think
they got
it. A painter, Max Ernst. Et la vision que mon père avait de la science-fiction était une vision surréaliste. C'est-à-dire, cette idée en fond que le. Ce qui est très important dans le surréalisme, c'est cette idée que le rêve fait partie du réel et nourrit le réel.
The vision that my father had was a vision surrealiste that it comes from dreaming, from a part of a dream, what we think. Hmm? What we think is a part of a dream.
And a part of reality. Of a real. Le réel, comme on dit, le réel. C'est le voilà, c'est plus que la réalité. En tout cas, ça nourrit, ça doit nourrir la réalité. You must feed.
It feeds reality.
Voilà, it feeds reality.
It feeds reality.
Exactly. We must not forget our dreams and try to accomplish them every time.
Yes, okay. Sorry.
Non, non, c'est bon. C'est... Et quand j'ai, par exemple, commencé à lire Philippe K. Dick, c'était vraiment dans cette optique-là, l'optique qui était un bain qui était celui-là en fait, qui était celui du surréalisme, et celui d'une vision surréaliste de la science-fiction.
When I started reading Philip K. Dick, it was exactly this vision. It was surrealistic, the way I approached it.
So, voilà. I think to begin, just to explain you, and perhaps another another anecdote, peut-être aussi, c'est je savais, par exemple, que je connaissais les films de mon père. J'ai été, par exemple, j'ai toujours en tête les instruments de torture du Moine, qui sont films de 1972.
I knew my father's films, and I also knew the tortures.
Oui, non, il a fait un film en 1972. Qui s'appelle Le Moine.
He created a film 1972, which was called The Monk.
En fait, il parlait peu, notamment des séries. Donc, je savais qu'il y avait des séries de policiers, comme les Lancaster, par exemple, ou Allopolis. Les Lancaster ou Allopolis.
I knew that he did a series,
French series.
A French TV series called Lancaster.
Lancaster ou Allopolis. Voilà. Allopolis.
Allopolis.
D'ailleurs, pour l'anecdote, il y a eu une grève de la télé parce que mon père avait présenté en Lancaster un flic qui était un peu pourri et il voulait sucrer, en fait. La télé voulait sucrer cette fin ou sucrer toute la série parce que, voilà, quand on dit sucrer, c'est la virer et l'enlever, en fait. Hein. Parce que c'était une image d'un policier qui n'était pas une image propre, on va dire.
He had created an image of a policeman. Policeman is not the right word. I should use another word. The word cop, which wasn't the purest, the cleanest, the best thing to say. He somehow inverted the image existing till that time.
Voilà,
the way people perceived those.
Voilà. Voilà, il y a eu une grève pour soutenir mon père dans ce conflit-là, à l'ORTF.
Pour
maintenir la
support what he was saying there.
Et ce qui est vraiment très curieux, c'est que Sial 4 n'est passé qu'en Suisse, comme j'ai dit tout à l'heure, hein, just passed in Switzerland. Et avant que Costas ne m'en parle, je ne savais pas que ça existait. En fait.
Sial 4 was shot in Switzerland, but never in France, and I didn't know that it existed.
Ouais.
Okay, so we informed him. Yes.
Et ce qui est d'autant plus curieux, que je suis un spécialiste de la science-fiction et que j'utilise la science-fiction pour penser le monde, en fait. Hein, donc,
I use science-fiction, it's what I do, and I didn't know that.
Voilà, c'est un peu un paradoxe.
My own father had created such a series, which is what I do.
Voilà. Donc... ça, c'est le panorama. Je vais peut-être parler un peu de la série, hein, et de la vision de la série.
I'm going to speak about the series now.
Voilà. Je vais essayer de prendre plusieurs points et de juste vous donner quelques clés.
I'm going to take certain points and give you some keys to for your comprehension, to understand.
And not perhaps only to understand, because it's easy to understand, mais aussi pour... s'interroger sur pourquoi est-ce qu'on regarderait Sial 4 aujourd'hui.
Yes, maybe not exactly to understand because it's easy to understand, but just to wonder yourselves why do we watch this series or why are we expected to watch this series today?
Parce que mine de rien, une série noir et blanc de science-fiction avec peu de moyens, des grosses ficelles.
We are talking about science fiction, and it's back in the 60s, it's black and white, low budget.
Une grosse ficelle, it means
fake things, yeah. Not the effects employed in in modern science fiction filmography.
It's not exactly Dune by Denis Villeneuve. If you not exactly the same budget. Also, voilà, je parle de Dune de Denis Villeneuve.
It wasn't the same budget.
Voilà. Donc le premier point et alors je ne sais pas si vous savez aussi que le film était inspiré d'un roman de 1959.
I don't know if you know that this film was inspired by a novel from 1959. I have an issue with numbers tonight.
C'est Edmond Cooper. En anglais, c'est Deadly Images. Et le titre en français est assez intéressant parce que c'est Pygmalion 2113.
The title in French is interesting. It's Pygmalion.
Oui, 2113.
2113.
Et alors, pour un peu vous donner ces quelques clés, je vais essayer de les éclairer un petit peu comme ça.
I could give you some keys just to make things a little clearer.
Si on peut dire. Premier point. La catastrophe, la fin du monde.
First point, the end of the world, catastrophe.
Cette idée que le maître en scène, et auquel je crois beaucoup, en tant que lecteur de Philip K. Dick, que la fin du monde, c'est pas la fin du monde, c'est la fin de notre monde.
The end of the world is not the end of the world, it's the end of our world.
Voilà. Cette idée est très très forte dans le film, surtout au début.
This is a very strong idea dominating the whole movie.
Ce qui est assez intéressant, c'est que les 20 premières minutes, la première moitié de la série, se situe donc dans l'aujourd'hui, donc dans les années 60. Donc, du premier épisode, tout à fait.
What is interesting is that during the first episode, the first 20 minutes, the first episode.
Yeah, c'est ça. First 20 minutes of the first episode.
Yes.
The Wolf.
It's about today.
Today.
Mm-hmm. It is about today, yes.
Et,
it goes on now.
Voilà. Et c'est très très peu présent dans le roman.
And this is very present.
Non, très peu, très peu. Très peu. Ça n'existe quasiment pas.
This doesn't exist in the novel. Sorry.
It's very très très peu, juste un tout petit peu comme une sorte de flashback en fait.
Only as a flashback in a very small, portion.
Et ce point-là est primordial parce que dans ces premières 20 minutes, on se rend compte que la catastrophe, l'apocalypse, n'est pas simplement dans l'environnement, elle est mentale. En fait.
And this, what is very important, and is that this catastrophe, this apocalypse, a Greek word, is not only in the world, but it's a mind apocalypse.
Voilà. Au point, et ça n'existe pas dans le roman, que le personnage le plus sensé est un professeur qui conduit ivre.
This doesn't exist in the novel that it's a person driving a philosopher
I didn't complètement ivre sous voilà alcoolique voilà
well, yes who is drunk and drives
totally drunk
and donc c'est. Et ce renversement, en fait, est quelque chose qui était toujours très présent chez les surréalistes et chez lui. C'est-à-dire que c'est le fou qui détient une part de la réalité, et en plus le fou qui va se suicider, en plus. Donc c'est d'autant plus violent.
The crazy person who takes a part of the reality and he commits one piece of truth and commits suicide.
Et là, c'est ce qui est là où, en fait, ce premier épisode, il rejoint, par exemple, mes deux auteurs très connus, et qui sont deux auteurs, évidemment, de l'époque, qui sont J.G. Ballard, qui est anglais, tout comme Edmund Cooper, hein, donc J.G. Ballard, et Philip K. Dick, qu'on a déjà cité. C'est-à-dire que chez ces deux auteurs, J.G. Ballard et Philip K. Dick, la raison de l'effondrement de l'apocalypse n'est pas importante. Ce qui est important, c'est qu'est-ce qui se passe pour, et c'est le décor que cela crée. Et c'est ça qui les rend contemporains.
This episode, we can see two important authors.
J.G. Ballard et Philip K. Dick.
One is English, one is French, one is English.
In fact, J.G. Ballard is English, and Philip K. Dick is American, but quite a special American guy. And in fact, in their novels, there is something which is quite important. Is that les causes, c'est dans ces choses, les causes de l'effondrement ne sont pas le plus important.
The reason of their
collapse
is not what matters.
Voilà. What matters is what occurs inside the mind of people and in the world.
It's exactly what you mentioned at the beginning, that what matters is a mental procedure,
But a link between the mental procedure and what occurs in the world.
And what happens in the
world. The link between the two are the most important.
The combination, yes. Okay.
And ce point-là, en fait, est primordial, et c'est parce que, en tout cas, moi, c'est mon sentiment, aujourd'hui, notre monde n'attend pas l'apocalypse. Il est dedans déjà. On est dans la fin de notre monde, on est en train de la vivre.
And this is my point. The point I want to make is that we are already there. It's not something we are waiting. We have already reached that point, beginning of the beginning of the apocalypse.
Not part of the apocalypse. I think the beginning of the end of our world, which people think it's perhaps the end of the world, but which is not the end of the world, which is just the end of one world that we don't want anymore anyway.
Voilà. You said that in English.
Voilà, ouais. Et ce point est assez primordial parce que c'est ce qui rend contemporain des auteurs comme J.G. Ballard, comme Philippe K. Dick, ou comme la vision de l'effondrement qu'avait mon père.
What makes these authors really contemporary, and we can link them with the present, is this thing that... can you repeat en français? What makes them
contemporain, voilà, moderne.
Yes. Ouais.
Voilà.
Pour le dire différemment,
to say this in a different way.
À l'époque, le principal danger, Gunther Anders, le philosophe, elle, déjà, le disait dans un bouquin qui s'appelait La fin du monde, la fin de notre temps. La fin de notre temps, the end of our time. Donc la grande terreur, c'était la terreur atomique. Mais mon sentiment est que le réchauffement climatique, ce qu'on est en train de vivre et ce qui nous attend, en fait, au fond, finalement, peut-être. Voilà, la manière dont des autres, the way that authors like Ballard, Dick, or perhaps a little my father in another way, the way they treat this thing, atomic bomb, like something we don't know what it is, where it comes, something mysterious in a way, is a little bit like the climate change today. There's something, a link between the two, which is quite important. We don't feel it exactly, but voilà. Et ce point de relier ce que nous avons dans notre tête avec ce qui se passe dans le monde est pour moi quelque chose de primordial.
The way we can combine what happens in the world with what's in on our minds is what matters.
What matters. Et c'est d'autant plus que justement les fictions définissent potentiellement des horizons de monde alternatif.
Fiction shapes
potentially, yes, exactly. We have forgotten that. We have forgotten that fiction can potentially shape other kind of worlds, of worlds. Voilà. And it's something which is, according to me, very important. In fact, that we are searching today horizons and des chemins. Voilà.
We are looking for pathways.
Pathways and horizons.
And horizons.
And that's why fiction are quite important today. Et donc cette vision de l'effondrement de l'apocalypse, à mon avis, elle peut nous parler.
And this vision can actually talk to us.
Aussi parce qu'il y a de l'humour.
Because there is also the sense of humor within.
Je ne sais plus si à la fin du premier épisode, on le voit, mais le personnage de ce professeur fou, on va le retrouver après, en fait. Et toute la série fonctionne avec des réminiscences, des clins d'œil.
The whole series is functioning with recalling what?
Clin d'œil, des clins d'œil aussi, des réminiscences, des clins d'œil.
Réminiscences,
clins d'œil.
Cling.
Et si vous écoutez bien, vous verrez que à plein de moments, il y a des phrases totalement absurdes.
If you're listening well, you will see that there are some phrases absurd.
And sometimes a phrase, one of these absurd phrases of a beginning can come back 2 hours after in the third or fourth. If you listen, you will find some things that are coming back in a way. Donc, ce premier point, c'est la vision de la catastrophe, the vision of collapse, which is something quite interesting, according to me. The second point is surrealism. C'est que cette vision, en fait, du film est une vision, en tout cas, avec toutes les imperfections, c'est une vision surréaliste, c'est-à-dire que le réel et le rêve s'interpénètrent en permanence.
It's a vision surrealistic, the dream, the reality, interconnect, there is interconnection.
Il y a par exemple des scènes où on ne sait pas si elles sont réelles ou pas.
There are some scenes we don't know if they are real or not.
Vous ne l'avez pas encore vu, mais à un moment donné, il y a par exemple une sorte de... On a l'impression d'être à Tahiti, dans une sorte de lieu. On ne sait pas si c'est vrai ou pas. En fait,
You haven't seen this since yet.
It's in another third episode, I think, or something like that.
It's in another episode when we don't know if this scene is something real or not.
Donc voilà. Donc le collapse, le surréalisme, qui est une manière de voir le monde, pour moi, en fait.
Collapsing and surrealism are ways to look at the world, in my opinion.
Ensuite, le troisième point évident, c'est la robotique, c'est les androïdes.
The third point I would like to make is robotics.
Voilà, la technologie.
The technology.
Alors là, évidemment, mon père ou Edmund Cooper n'ont rien inventé.
Obviously, at that point, my father.
And Edmund Cooper, le writer, the writer. Voilà. Ce qui est intéressant dans le... Alors, il y a deux points qui sont liés, et ce qui est très intéressant, c'est que, je pourrais donner des exemples par rapport à ça, c'est la manière dont justement la robotique, l'androïde, se connecte à l'utopie et à la dystopie.
What is very interesting, a point which is very interesting, is how robotics is connected with utopia and dystopia.
Ça, c'est dans la science-fiction, bien évidemment, les nouvelles technologies sont très souvent utilisées à des fins utopique ou dystopique. Bien évidemment que dans cette logique, en fait. Alors,
it's obvious that this logic.
Oui, voilà. J'essaie de dire de façon simple. En essayant, il y a un livre qui est sorti il y a un an à peine d'un des plus anciens, des plus vieux auteurs de science-fiction française qui s'appelle Philippe Turval.
There is a book, French fiction. Yes. Science fiction novelist called
Philippe Curval.
Philippe Curval.
Son bouquin s'appelle Le paquebot immobile. Voilà, Le paquebot immobile. Il a 90 ans. Hein. Philippe, c'était un ami de mon père.
Mm-hmm. He was a friend of my father's.
Et le paquebot immobile.
Le paquebot. Aquí, de Croisière.
Voilà.
Mobile ship.
Immobile ship.
Voilà.
Et c'est une île créée par les anarchistes dans un monde effondré. Voilà.
An island created by anarchists.
Sur le continent de plastique du Pacifique.
In a world of plastic.
Voilà.
An island created by anarchists in a world of plastic.
In a continent of plastic.
In a continent of plastic.
Et ce qui est très intéressant, c'est qu'on voit dans ce roman, comme dans plein d'autres romans de science-fiction, comment l'utopie, le désir d'utopie se nourrit en quelque sorte de technologie pour, là en l'occurrence dans le paquebot immobile, permettre l'abondance, on va dire.
In this book, we can see how technology is connected with utopia, is nourished. Is nourished by utopia. Yeah.
Et comment l'utopie technologique tombe très facilement dans la dystopie, en fait. Voilà.
So this is the intervention we talked about technology and utopia and dystopia.
Utopia converts to dystopia.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm. Changes to dystopia.
And sometimes in the other potentially dystopia could become utopia. We don't know exactly.
But of course, we don't know.
And what is very strange, in fact, parce que parmi les mots clés, il y a celui de la robotique, il y a celui du bonheur, en fait, qui est un autre mot clé par rapport à un film comme Sial 4. C'est-à-dire que utopie, bonheur.
Another key word, of course, is utopia, happiness.
Parce que et ça, c'est un truc qui m'a beaucoup étonné, c'est que moi qui milite pour le revenu universel et qui contre la notion d'emploi, je considère que l'emploi est une fumisterie, en fait, et qui je milite pour le revenu universel. Donc, universal revenue. The fact to have an employment is, according to me, something completely stupid, in fact. It's interesting to work. Like to make really something, like makers, you make something really interesting. But for example, breeding a child is making something. Create an association is create something. But working for Total is not creating anything. And it's not because you have an employment that it has sense. Et donc, dans Ciel 4, il y a l'utopie potentiellement dystopique de la fin du travail.
Dans the series Ciel 4, there is the utopia and dystopia. These two notions, while
la fin du travail, end of work,
related to the end of the world,
the work.
Yes, an intervention between.
La fin du travail salarié, si on préfère, en fait, hein, la fin du travail salarié. Donc, et c'est un grand classique de l'utopie depuis Lafarge et le droit à la paresse,
qui est l'idée que les technologies pourraient nous aider à nous débarrasser du fardeau du travail.
The technology could help us
get rid of.
Yes.
Of the work.
Well, of le poids du travail, quoi. Le,
yes.
Et donc ça, c'est une ce que je trouve, ce qui à mon sens en tout cas est très passionnant et très contemporain, c'est que...
It's very contemporary. We are talking about the CL4 and it's another reason he finds it very contemporary.
Voilà. C'est ce rapport, on va dire, ce double rapport en fait de la technologie à la fin du travail, donc... The link between technology and the end of work.
The double relation voilà. Between technology and
the end of work, and also, perhaps, what could be creating life. Voilà, j'ai dit voilà, what could be creating life. Voilà, oui, on peut tutoyer. Voilà, creating life. Et vous le verrez au fur et à mesure, c'est que évidemment que la personnage robot Diana est évidemment primordiale dans l'ambiguïté, en fait, de la série, qui est notre ambiguïté contemporaine, en fait, qui est l'ambiguïté du rapport potentiel à la vie de la technologie ou du rapport au travail de la technologie.
La relation avec the relation with the work and technology.
Voilà, and the dream of.
I will say in English, perhaps. It's these two things which are. It's quite strange that these two things are linked. That is the end of the work, the salary work. And another thing which is classical, which you can find in Blade Runner, for example, Do Android Dreams of Electric Sheep, de Philippe K. Dick, qui est. Cette question de la conscience et de la vie, this question of the consciousness and the life of machines, like a dream, in fact. And is a machine capable of emotion? Can it be perhaps in a short time, perhaps in a very, very long time? We don't know, but this is this question, in fact, which is a mythological question, which is, and all novels like or film like Blade Runner, or CL4 in its way, well, perhaps with this low budget, this white, with this way, which is bricolage. Hein? I say c'est plus du bricolage.
Yes.
It's
kind of patchwork. Voilà. Not well thought.
Yes.
Cold field. Voilà. Cold field.
Voilà. Something. Okay.
A combination of different.
Mais ce que j'essaie de vous dire là, en fait, je vais l'éclairer.
What I would like to tell you to make things clearer.
Je vais l'éclairer au travers de justement de c'est quels sont les deux imaginaires fondamentaux qui ont fait que j'en ai fait 600 pages. Oh. Là, voilà.
To talk about the book, yes, about the imaginary of the future. Mm.
So, in this book, I try to understand our sideration, the fact that we are like, we cannot do what to do in front of the technological demesure of Silicon Valley, of transhumanism. There's something like, well, they can do everything, no limits. And in the same times, collapse, ecological environment, return to the limit, the exact contrary. And the collapse saying all is going to be down is also a way for us, a mean of sideration. We feel that we cannot act towards technology that they say that will save us, which is quite incredible. We do nothing, so. And in the same time, the environment, which we live with COVID-19 or all these kind of things, it's another kind of situation, which is the exact opposite. And
According to me, we must really try to think with fiction, with science fiction, with series, these two huge imaginaries, which is our due, which is our imagination. We are, and we must think the end of our world, and we must think technologies and the danger of technologies, and have the hopes also, and we must take off these things from ideologists, and to make things, to make projects, to make fictions, and what, according to me, ce qui d'après moi est passionnant, c'est que ces thématiques de l'effondrement, en collapse, the team collapse, technologies, robotics, androids, in art, by not this term, but artificial intelligence, but it's this idea of artificial intelligence, it's robotics, all the kind of things. Work, the end of work, and with all that, which is really our, notre imaginaire, according to me, contemporain d'aujourd'hui. Et Ado, il rajoute, et c'est lui, pour le coup, c'est mon père donc, qui rajoute ça.
It's my father who is adding this element.
Il y rajoute la révolution.
He adds the revolution.
La résistance.
The resistance, the same one.
In a way which can seem a little old-fashioned, of course. Voilà, d'une façon qui peut être un peu old-fashioned. Voilà. Mais qui pose la question du libre arbitre.
He asks the question.
Libre arbitre.
Yes.
Liberty, if you prefer.
Yes, liberty, arbitrary.
Et voilà.
Free arbitrary.
Voilà.
Free arbitrary.
Bon.
Voilà. Libre.
Et qui sont des, aujourd'hui, puisqu'on est là pour parler de séries, alors je vais citer des séries américaines, mais...
It was an American series, we are
voilà, here voilà, about it. But il y avait, je ne sais pas si vous connaissez Westworld, par exemple, ou Raised by Wolves, ces deux séries.
I Westworld, don't know if you are aware voilà, of Westworld.
Westworld or Raised by Wolves.
But what is
quite strange for me is that, for example, Monde Ouest, which is a film with Yul Brynner, in 1972 or something like that. It's about robots, androids, who voilà, c'est qui se révoltent dans un parc d'attraction.
They are revolting. It's their action. Robots revolt.
Exactly.
Robots revolt.
In a park, dans un parc d'attraction.
To attraction.
Voilà.
Yeah.
Voilà. Il y a, par exemple, la clé de ces parcs d'attraction, c'est tout simplement de les tuer sans cesse, ces robots, en fait. Hein. On est, par exemple, dans le monde ouest, on est des cow-boys, et ils sont sans cesse dégommés. Donc, ils sont sans cesse tirés dessus, quoi. Voilà, ils sont sans cesse, ils meurent, quoi, en quelque sorte. The robots are just always down, because they are here to be killed by us, perhaps not us, because I don't think we will have enough money to be there and to profit of this attraction park. But et il y a une scène dans Sial 4 qui date de 1969 où des humains font la chasse aux robots.
And the humans kill the robots in the series.
Mais comme une chasse, comme un amusement.
And
en fait.
They do it for entertainment.
Ça, par exemple, c'est quelque chose qui n'est pas dans le livre de Edmund Cooper.
This, for example, is something which is not in the book.
Et c'est fou. Mon père adorait Monde Ouest. Donc, il loves Monde Ouest, le film.
Yes, my father loved the film Monde Ouest.
Et aujourd'hui, il y a une série qui s'appelle Westworld, avec 3 saisons, qui fait un carton chez les jeunes.
Today, there is a series called Westworld.
It is a hit.
Yes.
It's a hit. Among young people. And it's exactly the same idea. Exactly the same meaning, the same questions.
Concept.
Voilà.
Yes.
Avec en plus cette métaphore où potentiellement
And it's this metaphor.
Où potentiellement le robot, l'androïde, peut devenir aussi le noir, la personne minoritaire, la personne pourchassée potentiellement.
The android can become somebody to be killed, to be.
Voilà.
As a colored people.
Ouais, yes. As a colored people. De la même façon qu'à l'inverse, le plus souvent, c'est l'inverse.
In the same way, most often it's the opposite.
C'est-à-dire que c'est les robots, les androïdes qui sont utilisés par les pouvoirs pour chasser les humains récalcitrants.
The robots, the androids are used in that way.
Pour poursuivre, voilà.
Yes,
voilà.
Yes.
Donc voilà, donc c'est évidemment un peu difficile comme ça entre français, anglais,
it's a little difficult
grec.
With the
voilà, oui.
And the absence of Greek.
Voilà, ce que moi me semble intéressant en tout cas, c'est de réaliser que malgré les apparences de ringardise.
What would interest me anyway is that. Although there are similarities,
les ringards, être ringard en fait, c'est old fashioned, dépassé, quelque chose de dépassé, quelque chose de dépassé, voilà.
Things belonging, yes, to old past. Fashioned, voilà. To the past.
Les rapports sont bien là en fait.
There is a great relation between that period and now.
Our period.
This is what makes it contemporary, what we explained before.
Voilà, malgré la forme.
Voilà. Despite all this old-fashioned and English.
Le point aussi, évidemment, c'est ce dont j'ai déjà parlé, mais qui est primordial, c'est ce questionnement entre l'utopie et la dystopie.
The point I've already talked about it is the relation between utopia and dystopia.
La dystopie n'est pas le contraire de l'utopie.
Dystopia is not the contrary of utopia.
C'est l'ombre de l'utopie.
It's the shade of utopia.
Ça veut dire quelque chose dont on doit avoir conscience en permanence lorsqu'on construit les utopies.
Something that we should be conscious about so that we can have the power to create utopia.
Le contraire de l'utopie, c'est l'idéologie dominante.
The opposite of utopia is the ideology of
dominante.
The dominant ideology.
Et dans Ciel 4, c'est très précisément le problème, c'est que
the problem in Ciel 4
que le bonheur est devenu le dogme.
The happiness of the coming of
est devenu un dogme, est devenu.
Yeah, the happiness is becoming a dogmatic. A dogma,
voilà,
un
dogme. Est devenu l'idéologie dominante.
It's the dominant. It's what the dominant ideology.
La raison du contrôle.
Yes, the reason.
Le contrôle, de la transformation des esprits, de voilà.
The transformation of the mind.
Donc c'est comme si quelque part. Les créateurs d'utopie, parce que c'est une utopie dans Ciel 4,
as if some were the creator of utopia,
n'avaient pas fait assez attention à leur ombre.
Hasn't paid attention to this shadow, to this shade.
Et avait ainsi transformé leur utopie en idéologie dominante, donc en dystopie.
And he has also
leur utopie, l'utopie de la fin du travail. Voilà.
Yes, utopia, he has transformed it into.
Voilà, une sorte, en idéologie dominante, en dogme.
Yes,
voilà,
as what dominates, the dominant notion in the book.
Et donc les deux clés qui, en tout cas dans le film d'ado, de mon père, donc Adonis Kirou, les deux clés qui permettent, et on peut trouver ça niais, hein.
The two keys which allow that we can find.
Niais, c'est-à-dire naïf.
Yes.
Naïf.
the two kids which are found naive.
We could find naive. C'est
we could call them something naive is
l'amour et la révolution.
Yes, love and revolution.
Voilà. Donc quand il irait aujourd'hui. Mais un amour, ce qui est intéressant, c'est aussi l'amour déçu, c'est-à-dire l'amour impossible toujours, en fait. Hein.
Yes, impossible love.
Y compris par rapport à un androïde, comme dans Blade Runner.
We can understand impossible love.
With an android, for example, like in Blade Runner. In Blade Runner, hein, Rachel in Blade Runner of in the film of Ridley Scott of in 1982, there's this love story, which is not really a love story, this relation between Rachel and Harrison Ford, Rick Deckard, voilà. And we always, there's always something linked to that kind of thing, and that's this virus of love in this film and also in Sialkat, in a lot of books also, a lot of fictions, a lot of stories. So voilà. Et par rapport à l'aujourd'hui. Voilà, moi qui travaille beaucoup sur ces questions d'utopie, de dystopie.
In relation with today, I have worked a lot on this question of utopia and dystopia.
C'est-à-dire que partout aujourd'hui, je ne sais pas si vous le ressentez, on a le sentiment que les gens sont en demande d'utopie, hein, de futur plus positif.
We have the feeling that people demand, people want a utopia and have a positive feeling.
Hier, par exemple, on a un gros événement avec Martine, et l'un des groupes qui majeur en France qui aide les migrants s'appelle Utopia 56.
Yesterday,
we have an event.
There was an event which is called Utopia.
Non, we've one of these project initiatives present there was named Utopia 56, and it's one of them organizations, small organization, association with a lot of young people, helping migrants, exiled people.
C'était
à Paris, c'était in Paris, it was in Paris.
So they found this organization in Paris.
Voilà, et donc pour finir, parce que je crois que le temps passe. Voilà, pour finir, voilà. Voilà, et qui, voilà, si vous avez des questions, peut-être.
Some questions you would like to
voilà, moi qui interviens beaucoup sur ces questions d'utopie, je pense que voilà comme je le disais, c'est qu'on a absolument besoin de mener des réflexions, de nous abreuver de fictions qui sont elles-mêmes des utopies. Et alors, perhaps I'm not. I've said that before. So perhaps that one example to finish is one offer which my father was. It was also a sort of friend of my father, and I read a lot of books of this guy, whose name is John Brunner. And John Brunner makes a book which is Stand to Zanzibar, Tous à Zanzibar in France, ou Sur l'onde de choc, The Shockwave Rider. Et il fait des dystopies, he makes dystopia, but inside dystopias, there are always a little utopia. For example, in The Shockwave Rider, it's a sort of a ultra-conformist world. It's United States, totally conformist, totally just with control and all that. And we discover, it's a book of 1975, by the end, an utopia in a little, in California, a little town, which had an earthquake, a sort of a new kind of city, created by scientists and people from there, which were victims of this earthquake. And it's quite incredible reading that, because it's like commons, but also digital commons, and this little city is a sort of utopia in the dystopia. And we have the same thing in Stand to Zanzibar. We have Beninia, which is a little African state, with an art de vivre, on say an art de vivre.
The art of, voilà, of life.
Voilà,
an art of living.
Voilà, which is quite fantastic. And it's inside a dystopia, and it's very important for us to work to be inspired and coming to me by this kind of stories, because it can convince us that we can create in our world, even if we think it's a dystopia, some little piece of utopias, and we will need to do it. Excuse me to be so long.
If there are some questions you would like to, and you can take one or two. If somebody wants to, yes.
Hi, thank you very much being here. I was wondering if the three mentioned pillars by you are resistance, revolution, and love, even if the last two ones are a bit naive. What about the psychoanalysis, related psychoanalysis?
La synchronicité?
Psychoanalysis, psychanalyse.
La psychanalyse, ah.
La psychanalyse. Because it was so much related to surrealistic movement. So this is my one question, related to your father too. And following that first question, what do you think, according to your opinion, is the difference between the production of science fiction films, American ones and European ones, which we really miss? We don't have so many. I mean, is there another approach to American projects which is really entirely related to their budget and the impressive visual effects, and the European ones might be something else? I don't know if I am understandable. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Oui, à peu près.
It's difficult to answer to these two questions. For the first one, I would say that my father was interested by a psychanalyst, but a sort of savage psychanalyst, like the one of Philip K. Dick, for example, which is to say that he wasn't fan of what we would call sort of a dogmatic psychanalyst schools in France. The schools, psychanalytic schools, were quite strong. So it's a meaning, to try to understand what's going on in the mind of people was important for the surrealist movement, but also for my father. But it was more about dream and liberation of mind than just psychanalysis. That's why I could speak about a rude psychanalyst from the streets, not from the cabinets, in fact. Okay, and not from the great psychanalysts, from the people just here when we go out in the street. This kind of psychanalyst, the rude people, psychanalysts of rude people, trying to understand things which occurs to them. So it was more this kind of psychanalyst, which is not really psychanalyst, of course, but was important for him, according to me, and that we can feel perhaps in some of his films, especially in Sialkat. About series, I have really some difficulties to find some, especially by example, science fiction series from Europe. This is quite strange, of course, but there have been some films, of course, but series, it's true that the one which came in my mind are unfortunately more American than European. I believe there will be something to create there, something to investigate. We had some authors like Stanislas Lem, like which was Czech, Stanislaw Lem. And we have some offers in East Europe. We have a lot of French and offers of science fiction. I have created also a not me alone, but a group in France with main an international group which main is le réseau, the network Plurality University, and we try to think and to invite. We are going to do something in a festival in Amsterdam on November, which name is Other Futures, and the fact to try to find fictions, series, films, stories, not only from US and the main Europe, is really a work. So we invite people from Africa, from Asia, and not only people, because now Netflix is also producing film with countries, La Casa de Papel from Spanish, we have a Mexican series also, but it's difficult, it's the Korean series, somehow are quite astonishing sometimes, quite unusual. But according to me, perhaps my knowledge of that is less, is perhaps, I think Costas could have more, perhaps, knowledge about all that. But of what I know, it's really a field to investigate, which is not so, perhaps because of a lack of budget, a lack of people to finance it, but perhaps you could have an answer about that.
France Arte, the France channel Arte, began to invest quite a lot of money to make science fiction films. Well done, but not so much well thought as American science fiction. Dystopian or utopian things. The Nordic countries also, they try to do some things, anticipation things, political, much more political than anticipation, pure science fiction.
Yes, there's one example which is very interesting, is Real Humans, which is made by Danish.
It's a Danish
series, which is quite interesting, because we really have the kind of a same feeling stories, but with another kind of view. That, for example, Westworld or Ciel 4. It's, I think today, according to, especially in France, we have some series from the Nordic, North European, Swedish, Sweden, etc., all these countries, more perhaps than Balkan countries.
They are much more intellectual, the Danish and the French ones. There are much more talking. It's less and less in action. When we see Westworld, we are completely taken inside. We're waiting. When we see now the French or the humans, you need to reflect all the time. So it may be quite tiring at 8:30 in the night to see that in prime time. When you see Westworld, you are completely, you can spend hours and hours and days and days. You are completely taken inside. You are part of that. The Nordic people, the same thing. I don't know why. I don't know. I can say why. Because they still think that it's related to politics. They are not quite metaphysical. They are very intellectual, purist, and formalist. They are good, but you don't have the wish to see them, to watch them next second time. Westworld, yes. Second and third time. So it's something to think about. If Greece, the Serbian people, they have very well done gore movies and series, more and more. They are specialized in that, I don't know why, and fantastic. But now they are looking to produce science fiction series, the Serbian people. I don't know Greece, if we don't have a tradition of that. But maybe it's time to do something, I don't know how.
Again, we're coming back to what Caterina Bay, the writer.
We are coming back to what Caterina Bay, our writer, who gave that masterclass yesterday, who today, this morning. Oh, it has been a long day, guys. referring to the budget. That budget really is an impact to the writers.
Yeah. Huh? Maybe it's quite true, Katerina. the fact that the budget is a key role to do that. Why we don't have a science fiction series?
Because science fiction or James Bond movies need a big budget. I mean, you must be crazy if you are a screenwriter and start writing science fiction in Greece.
But Greece has a great tradition of Gothic literature. You have a lot of young writers close to Salonika. They developed two or three publishing houses about Gothic and fantastic literature. Maybe it's something to see. But the channels, they don't consider this kind of literature, the Gothic, the hard, the heavy metal things. Well, it's not really excellent as the others, but they have their fans, more and more, young people, till the 30s. So maybe it's a kind of field new to investigate.
Mm. I think, yeah, and poetry, to make films with more poetry, less perhaps budget, but more poetry, I think it's perhaps something to explore. I think a lot of authors try to explore, but of course it's difficult to find budgets in Greece. Quite difficult, of course. Well.
So, Dionysios Samiotis, do you think that Tanweer maybe one day is going to produce a science fiction thing?
Who's going to write it? That's okay. We don't even have books. Yeah. Science fiction. I don't know. And sci-fi movies, series in free TV, that is the, you know, the mass media, they don't work. They don't even buy sci-fi movies, the TV channels. So there is a market, but it's a niche market. Science fiction is like art house. An art house, not art house commercials. It's art house. It's a genre. In general, there is no real market for genre movies, so even less for series of genre. You have to create it, but the way it's through platforms. If the platforms can open a path towards that, yeah, for sure, a lot of people will follow. But if a professional, they don't see a market, it's not easy for them, especially that you need skills. You need to. Science fiction is for me, it's a philosophy. So very, very difficult genre.
Of course. I think the first path, when I see what is just occurring now in France, I've just made a postface of Anthologia. Of science fiction authors, French authors, young French authors, some olders, and there's really just a huge amount of new science fiction authors in France, and which is quite incredible, that it's no more classical science fiction. There's always something about collapsing, something about poetry. It's no more this science fiction with a soap opera, special ship. I think there's something to explore there, which is no more, you know, all the etiquettes we had, they don't work, especially for us, according to me. This science fiction is a little bit of fantastic, really something, an expression of Jean Baudrillard, the philosopher. He said, speaking about J.G. Ballard and Philip K. Dick, he said something that the purpose was to inventer le réel comme fiction. Comme fiction, to invent not reality but the real as fiction. He said, in a world which is completely simulated, we must reinvent, use science fiction to reinvent reality, in fact, our reality, to construct it. Okay. And it's quite interesting because reading all these young French authors, they are really working in a field like that. It's no more soap opera. It's really something which is more metaphysical, more philosophical, more with more poetry, and with always, nearly always, this idea of the end of the world, of the end of our world, always present, in fact. I believe it's something which perhaps in 2 years, 5 years, 10 years, perhaps we could create something, because my belief is that in Europe we have the intellectual and all the skills, according to me, for this sort of poetry and philosophical science fiction. What we need perhaps is just to have a little more means for this poetry and philosophical science fiction to become also something which really attract the public. And I think the young public could be attracted by this kind of novels, and perhaps tomorrow series, etc. I think perhaps it's the beginning of something, because we really need that. We really need people. Why, for example, all this fantastic fantasy is just so working? Because we really need, in fact, this kind of fiction today, to explore other ways of thinking, of the way to project ourselves, in all that. And it's sometimes between fantasy, fantastic, and science fiction. We've always something linked to our reality today. Because, as I said, if we believe that there's not an apocalypse for tomorrow, but we will live in a period which is something linked to this feeling that we have to reinvent one world, because the world we used to live in is just beginning to collapse. It can be very violent in Brazil, in the United States with Trump, etc. It can be very powerful, of course. But if we have this feeling, I think fiction has a great role to play to create these horizons, or these alternative visions of the world, and perhaps to have ideas about paths to go there. And myself, I really find a lot of things in all that, but it's true that today, it's especially if you think about European creators of other creators than American ones or English ones, it's more today about literature. It's more about books, but than perhaps films. So perhaps because of budgets, I believe. And it's perhaps only beginning. But well, I think it's worth working. It's worth trying to invest in this field and this future. Excuse for my English, because I have a lack of practice, really.
Ariel,
I will let you read the book, if you read French.
You have done all this trip to join your father's memory by Sirius that you discovered by us. I have to confess that it was my son that he spoke me about this Sirius, okay, 29 years old, he told me, you know, Adonis Kiru, he shot also Sirius, and among them there's something really good, really science fiction.
And there's one thing which for me it's quite incredible, really quite incredible, is that I saw Ciel 4 exactly with the same mind and feeling than seeing a series I didn't know before. It was the first time this year that I saw Ciel 4. The first time. So the analysis I made today, it's an analysis about what I think today, about what I read today, about the work I'm dealing with fiction today, in fact. So it's, and for me, it's quite a strange feeling, in fact, to discover a creation of my father
as if it was a creation of today. A bit naive, low budget, old fashioned, but with ideas which are contemporary, which is quite quite astonishing for me, in a way, in fact.
So let's hope that the national broadcaster, who is doing a great job about heritage, well, you are the only representative of Earth, they always the same story, you know, addressing you. You represent all, the better or the worst, the best thing. Maybe that's the first movement. He's Greek, he's the diaspora, he's a quite intellectual, he's science fiction, he's low budget, he's everything. Just buy the rights to scream that. Anyway, we are going, thank you all of you, and we are going to maybe have a special day, the 4 episodes of CL in Athens or Salonika, maybe, yeah, it'll be interesting, and talk about Adonis Kyrou. Yeah, that's good. So, thanks a lot.